upon me. Thank you. the depth of the sea. Every creature unique in the sun, every server.
Let's start over.
Let's do that again.
Yeah.
Ready? The depth of the
next to you, give him a handshake and give him a hug.
Hello, good morning, everyone. Welcome to The Quest. My name is Christine Reyes. I'm Kids Quest Director. I have a few announcements. On Friday, Stop. Shucks. Okay. I have a few announcements. Okay, Marie, I'm not going to look at you. Okay, Friday, October 31st, we're going to do Trunk or Treat, and that's going to be here at the Quest. If you've never experienced Trunk or Treat before, it's really cool. We have about 20-something cars in the parking lot. The trunks are open and decorated and full of goodies. And the people from the neighborhood, they come, and the kids trick or treat or trunk or treat car to car. We have jumpies, and we have free food. And it's fun for not just for the kids, but for the grown-ups, too. And if you don't normally get trick-or-treaters at your house, I encourage you to please join this fun family event. Come and decorate your car, and it's just a lot of fun. I have clipboards going around if you can help. And if you also have any questions, just go ahead and ask David. Yeah, ask David. Last week, Franco came up and he talked about pizza lunch, and that happens on Wednesdays during lunchtime. The Novato High kids come, we serve them pizza. They come, they eat, they leave. It's really quick and easy, and it's just a great way to let these kids know that we care for them and we're there for them. There's about 100 kids that come here, but we do need volunteers to make this happen. So sign up on your connection card or let Franco know that you can help serve kids. When you came in today, you should have gotten one of these cards. It's called Dinners for Seven. And whether you've been here at the Quest a long time or just a short time, this is a great casual way to get together with other Questers. If you're interested, sign up, and you're going to be randomly put with seven other people. And are you going to have dinner together? And it's just a one-time thing. It starts next weekend. So sign up if you want to do that. And then finally, we have Saturday night supper, and we're going to try to do that once a month. And we're going to have one October 4th from 6 to 8 p.m. It's kind of like what we did over the summer where we had a barbecue and then Joe had a message afterwards. The thing is, it's going to be indoors, and we're going to have some karaoke and some fun, and then Joe's going to do his message. But it's a little different because we are still going to meet the next day. So make sure you put that on your calendar. Okay, Kids Quest, we can go.
We're going to sing Amazing Grace. We'd like you to join us, please. And as we do so, we're going to take the offering. If you're a guest here, we ask that you just, there's a communication card in front of you. If you want any information about the Quest and you want someone to contact you, go ahead and sign up on that connection card. For those of you who call this place home, please donate. We need your help. Let's sing Amazing Grace. Saved a wretch like thee.
Together. Before we pray, so that chain, your chains are gone. It's just true. It's just the truth. Your chains are gone. You've been set free. The problem is that we live so long with them on that even when they're removed, we still act as if we're bound by them. And really the process of growth is living more and more in what's already true about ourselves, that there is there's no chain on any wrist in this room. And it's difficult to believe that. That's our work, believing what's true. So God, we ask for your help in that process. That's what we need. We've learned to live in a certain way and have cut paths in our brain by the way we react and act, and it's hard to change. So I pray that you would give us a glimpse of what's really true, Father. Help us to see what's really true. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I can remember when I began seeing what was really true. It seems really hot to me, Amit. And it's, thank you. I had just read a book by this preacher by the name of Charles Swindoll. Has anyone ever heard of Charles Swindoll? He wrote this book called The Grace Awakening. And I was raised in a very conservative kind of Christian family, and I didn't really have a grasp on what grace was. But as I began understanding grace, I kind of had these moments where I would read a little bit and experience some new things and put the book down and say, could that really be true? That's a good question to ask. I mean, that's when I began to understand what Jesus called it when he was on earth. He called it the good news. And what I was really believing was okay news. And, I mean, it was kind of like regular news. The regular news is, if you're good, God likes you. If you're not good, God doesn't. Just like everybody else. That's not good news, is it? That's Santa Claus. If you're good, you'll get something under the tree. If you don't, you'll get coal. And that's kind of how I lived. And I'm not, you know, that's just how I heard and what I understood. But as I began realizing that there really is good news, that there is this idea of grace where God just loves me. That's what he not only loves me, but he is love. It's remarkable. Lynn was reading a book, and this is this is all precursor to the actual sermon, so sorry. But that song is an amazingly powerful song, isn't it? Lynn was reading us a book yesterday. We had a little bit of car time, and the author of the book said he was raised in a very fundamental Muslim household. And he said because of that, he came to the conclusion that he was an atheist, an atheist, theos, God, didn't believe in God. But he said, it was a beautiful book. What he said at the end of the book was, he does not believe in God, but he believes in love. And I thought to myself, well, good, he believes in God. Right? I mean, that's what God is. God is mathematically, poetically, grammatically, and any mechanically, and architecturally and agriculturally, God is love. That's what God is. And so if you believe and kind of lean into love, you're believing and leaning into God. And if you believe and lean into God, you're believing and leaning into love. And the process of growth is understanding that there is really nothing but love when it comes to God. That God is not loving, God is love. That's an amazing thing. It's an amazing thing. And it's not just okay news, okay, yeah, blah, blah, blah. Quid pro quo is kind of the way we live. Right? I mean, that really is quid pro quo. It's the way we live. I have a friend, and anytime I do something for them, they do something for me. I hate it. Like, well, I'll help with something, and then all of a sudden something will be on the doorstep. Thanks for doing this, and I guess I do the same thing. At least in some ways. We go to lunch and someone says, okay, I'll take the tab, and I say, let me leave the tip. Because I feel like I need to do something. I can't just receive. We're not very good at that. We're not very good at receiving something that we don't feel we paid for. But that's what this life with God is. And so I'm grateful for that. Really grateful for that. So Patty, thank you for that song. We're doing I have one announcement, and then we're actually going to get into the sermon here this morning. We're doing a seminar. When I say we, Miriam Martinez, who is a psychologist who comes to the Quest. She's a licensed marriage and family therapist, has a practice here in Novato. She and I are partnering together and are doing a relationship workshop on October the 11th. It's going to be at the Novato Community School District office. You know where that is, right on 7th? There's not very many spots open. This would be a good thing for you if you're hitched, or if you're not hitched, or if you're in a relationship, or you want to be in one someday. If the one that you're in is great, or if the one that you're in, you think, you know, if I just didn't have this person, I could be happy. This is the place for you on the 11th. It's only going to be a few hours. If you want more information on that, fill out your connection card as soon as you get to you. There's going to be a cost associated with this. And Miriam and I have been working on it for months and months, and I'm very excited about it and looking forward to it. It's going to be open to more than just the Quest, and so there are people who are already going to be there, and my hope is that some of you will be too if it would serve you. So that's all I have to say about that. So last week we began talking about spiritual wellness. And if wellness is the quality or state of being healthy in your body, mind, and in your soul, in your spirit, as a result of effort, then what is spiritual wellness? Now, I need to kind of do a little, we need to talk about this in just for just a moment. You can't really, it's hard to separate areas of wellness. Especially when it comes to emotional wellness and spiritual wellness. They're like, where does one start and the other stop? It's very difficult to delineate. In fact, not really helpful to delineate. This is emotional wellness, this is spiritual wellness, because we're one person. In fact, even when you talk about physical wellness, you may have experienced this sense of, if you feel like you're physically well and in good shape and kind of eating well, there's something about an emotional wellness that kind of seeps in, doesn't there? You feel better emotionally, maybe happier or more energetic, or, you know. If you don't feel like you're physically well, then it's difficult emotionally as well. And spiritually, I mean, it's all tied together. We're one. It's not like we're a million different pieces. But when I'm talking about the spiritual wellness part of us, I'm talking about our heart. How is your heart? That's really the question. Is it well? Is it well with your soul? I want to talk about this in a way that we started last weekend. We talked about it from this ancient way the church fathers said and say. A lot of kind of ancient spiritual writers, both in the Christian tradition and out of the Christian tradition, talk about three hallmarks to spiritual wellness. And this is helpful to me because it gives me some things to kind of take a little reading. I like gauges. Do you like gauges? Now, there's two different kinds of people in the world. There's people that read the gauges in their car, and there's people that don't. My father made sure that I was one of the people that read the gauges in my car. How's your oil pressure? In fact, this summer, I was driving across the country in my truck and driving to Pennsylvania. Hey, Dad, how you doing? Where are you? I'm in Omaha. Okay, how's your oil pressure? I am not making it up. And I love him for it. You're looking to keep an eye on that temperature gauge. How's your water temp? It's pretty good, right where it needs to be. Okay, and that oil pressure's up there? Yep, it's good. I read the gauges. I can remember once when I was in high school that I didn't read the gas gauge on my mother's station wagon. I was coming home very late at night. It was about 2 a.m, and I was coming through this small town in Pennsylvania in my mother's 1978 Chevy Malibu wagon. I can still see it. And I ran out of gas. Wasn't looking at the gauges. Now, when you run out of gas in my house, and you're 17 or so, you don't call home for help. You figure it out. So, I was only about 6 miles from home, and in the middle of this little Amish community, you know, and so I parked the car by the side of the road, and I walked home, and I was getting home just as my father was leaving for work. And he looked at me and said, what are you doing? I said, I ran out of gas over by Leola. And he said, and you walked here? I said, yep. Said, well, good job. And off he went. And so things like that taught me to pay attention to the gauges. So I love gauges. Now, there's some things that you can measure with a gauge and some things that you can't. And so when someone kind of, and not just kind of spur of the moment in a way that they say measure, but for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, men and women who are living in a deep and abiding relationship with God have said there are three gauges to keep track of if you want to know if there's a spiritual health about you. One of them is if you hold no resentments. The second one is if you don't react. That's interesting. And the third one is if you maintain inner peace. And so I want to take a look at those. And I just want to ask how we're doing in those three areas. So take a look at your gauges. How's your oil pressure? How is your resentment oil pressure? Now, we need to do a little bit of work to understand what they meant when they said hold no resentments. Do not resent. You know, resentment is an amazing word. It's actually a French word. Ressentir. It just means to feel again. That's what it means. So a resentment is you feeling over and over and over again the hurt that would have happened yesterday or the day before or 15 years ago. It means to feel that hurt again. And I think we all probably know what that feels like. Is there anyone here who hasn't had a resentment? I was just going to let you go. You know, go to Pete's and have a coffee and or come up here and help me. Okay, good. It's a mental replay of past hurts, disappointments, threats. So sometimes a mental replay of something that was hurtful either by what someone did or by what someone didn't do. It's a mental replay. Resentment is the mental process of replaying a feeling. And interestingly, as I was kind of working on this week, it occurred to me and it kind of became clear to me that a regret, you know the word regret? A regret is kind of a self-directed resentment. So when I resent myself, we refer to that as a regret, and we're going to talk more about that. All I want to do is be careful and are looking at this gauge and understand how we can kind of take the gauge out of the red and move it over to the green. If you're looking at gauges, it's an awful thing when you see the gauge, the temperature gauge. So Lynn and I were in Yellowstone on the way back from our trip. And what a beautiful place. Been to Yellowstone? Oh. And we hopped in the pickup truck. It's old. It's not a new truck. It's an old pickup truck, which is, you know, nice. And all of a sudden, we were just about to leave and drive a long way, and I noticed this green fluid under the truck. And I thought, ectoplasm. Either that or antifreeze, I wonder. Although, of course, it was antifreeze. And so, obviously, we had some kind of a leak, and I noticed the temperature gauge. As I was driving, and I kept all this quiet so as not to worry my wife, the temperature gauge started moving over and going from where, and now it's getting really close. And I realized what happened was there was a leak developed in the heater core. And the reason it leaked that morning, because it was cold in Yellowstone and I had the heat on, if I just turned the heat off, you could watch the gauge go back. But it's a hard thing when you see a gauge going over to the wrong direction. It's kind of frightening. And I want us to have enough information to kind of take a reading on our resentment gauge. Does that seem fair? It's interesting. Here's how you know if you have a resentment. At least one way. And I love this cartoon. Can you read it? Oh, not much. Guy sitting at his desk on the phone. Just sitting here sifting through an old scrapbook of past injustices and imagined slights. Anybody ever do that? Yeah. Our resentments are always working on the inside of us, kind of like a computer program that's working in the background. And when fresh hurts take place in ways that remind us of these past hurts, something happens. And this is how it works. I just want to give you three kind of ideas to think through. And I want you to kind of pay attention to this week as some of your homework. First of all, there's a trigger. A trigger. What's a trigger? A trigger is our most recent offense that opens up a long list of other offenses. A trigger is something that happens that opens up a whole kind of Pandora's box of deep feeling and resentment. Do you know what I mean? Something happens that isn't that big of a deal. Now, I don't know if you've ever fired a firearm. I did a lot more when I was younger, but a trigger is simply doesn't require very much force, but it creates an amazing amount of energy. So something can happen to you. Maybe it's someone who's cutting you off on the highway, or a close friend standing you up for a lunch appointment, or, I mean, we could get much worse, right? A forgotten birthday. A word that someone says to you that triggers another word, or, I mean, it could be a million things. A trigger is just a small little thing that happens to you, that reminds you of this big sense of energy, negative energy that's built up inside of you. That's what a trigger is. Ignition is what happens next. Ignition is simply our feelings rocketing to a maximum velocity which is disproportionate to the most recent offense. Does that make sense? So, somebody pulls the trigger and says, an interesting blouse choice. I didn't think we were going to do that anymore. Or, I mean, whatever it is, trigger. And all of a sudden, something happens to the other person. And it's completely disproportionate to what just happened. And that's where the third step, drama. Don't you love drama? Drama comes in. Drama is the resultant situation when someone will ask you something like this. Where did that come from? Anyone ever ask you that? What's up with that? All I said was, are you ready for the football game? All I said was, where did you want to go to lunch today? And I thought I was asking an innocent question. And then this ignition happens where all of this energy is released and this person says to you, well, what in the world? Why did... And you say something like this. I'm sorry. It's not your fault. I'm just tired, or I had a long day, or blah, 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 blah. We don't ever say, well, you know, what you did just triggered a huge resentment that I've got built up. and this resentment is playing out right now. And although you had nothing to do with the resentment, what you said triggered it, and there was this ignition inside my heart, and what you just felt was a lot of resentment that I really need to work on. Now that would be quite an answer. But the reason that we have the resentments is because we don't understand the process. So we can go, okay, well, good. Resentments then are kind of like a built-in self-protection system, right? Wrong. This is not good. I couldn't identify the author of this quote, and so the slide attributed to Nelson Mandela, the notes attributed to Carrie Fisher, those are the two that seem to have said it the most. I like it. Resentment is like drinking poison and then hoping it will kill your enemy. That's what resentment is. You do me dirty. I mean, let's just say, I mean, it was wrong. I'm not talking about something I made up. I mean, you did something to me that was very hurtful. And I get angry. And I go, okay, fine. If that's what you want to do, all right. You don't know who you're messing with. And I don't say that out loud, of course. But it deep inside me, inside my heart, inside my spirit, what happens is I begin to get resentful and anger begins to burn that I don't really want to take care of because it's actually pretty good once in a while to feel a slow burn, isn't it? It's kind of empowering. It's like, oh man, I'm just tired of all this forgiveness, lovey-dovey stuff. Give me a good resentment once in a while. That I can get my teeth into, especially when someone does something really stupid or really hurtful to you, and you go, great, I can hang on to that for a while. And we begin to actually enjoy it. Problem is, what it does is it starts releasing toxins into our system. Resentments. Resentments live inside us, feeding our negative feelings and emotions. They create a warped veil through which we see our life and all our relationships. Resentment allows our past to dictate our present and to change our future. That's what they do. Resentments are accumulative. Last night, I was working in my garage, and my friend Pat Macias came over, and we were having a great time, and I was trying to fix something on this. Had my hands deep inside a motorcycle engine. Couldn't get much deeper, could you, Patrick? I mean, there was parts everywhere, and I just have no idea how to put them back together. But there was a piston there, and this piston just had, this motorcycle has 28,000 miles on it, not a lot of miles, actually. But there is this big black accumulation on top of the piston, and as I was sitting there last night and Patrick left and I began scraping that off, I thought, wouldn't it be nice if you could take care of resentment like this? Because it looks just like this. A black carbon deposit on my heart. Now, after 28,000 miles of internal combustion, this piston accumulates a lot of black carbon, and it isn't good. So you scrape it off. That's why I love working on mechanical things. Because you can see the problem and you can scrape it off. Wouldn't it be nice if you could just call the resentment doc, say, yeah, doc, it's Joe. Oh, Joe, I haven't heard from you for a while. Yeah, I know. I need to come in for a good heart scraping. All right, Friday at 4. So I come in. He opens me up. Man, this is... It's just not like that. But the work is much harder. But it's terribly important, and you can do it. Resentments are cumulative. They add up. They get thicker and bigger and uglier. And actually what happens is, once we build up a few of them, it becomes our default mode. We get good at it. Because it's hard. Relationships are hard, aren't they? If you're married and you fell in love, you realized like in the second or third or fourth or fifth year, I don't know what year it was, that this isn't as easy as I thought it was going to be. I thought I was just always going to be this and you were always going to be that, and now I don't really want to do that anymore. I'm kind of angry about this and that. And, you know, relationships take a lot of work, and some days we're just not up to it. And so this stuff, plaque, starts building up. Jesus says it like this. I love this passage in Matthew chapter 6. In fact, if you want to read something from the Bible this week that will really help you, read Matthew chapter 6. Near the end of the chapter, Jesus says this. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow. There you go. Easy. Just don't worry about tomorrow. Now, he gives some ways not to worry earlier in the chapter. But he says at the end, therefore, don't worry about tomorrow. And then I love this phrase, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. That's true. And this is what I think he was talking about. Today, stuff is going to happen. Would you agree? Has it already happened? Stuff may have already happened to you today. And if you don't take care of it today, guess what's going to happen tomorrow? More stuff. It's like if you never take the garbage out. That's the big problem with having an empty nest now. I can't bark at one of the boys to take out the garbage. And so, unless you take it out every day, it begins to accumulate. Have you ever seen the show Hoarders? I never knew what a hoarder was. I think I've lived near some. But this show identifies someone who never wants to throw anything away. It's a psychological condition. It's a very difficult way to live as a hoarder. And their homes just fill up with stuff in ways that you just look at it and you say, this can't be true. And then you realize, and what I've realized is, a lot of us are resentment hoarders. We've let stuff build up a long time. So much so that there's like walls of stuff between us and everybody else. So, you know, I really love to have a good relationship, but I'm just waiting for the right person. I love it when people tell me that. I say something really like a smart aleck. You're like, well, when you find the right person, you know, don't date them because you don't want to inflict yourself on this poor person. See, that's the whole thing. We're always waiting for the right person when what we have to do is become the right person. I always think it's everybody else's fault when, in effect, some of it is, but some of it isn't. Jesus says, take care of today's stuff today. Don't let it build up. Don't let it become a resentment. That's the nature. They're kind of cumulative. They build up like a carbon deposit. Like, you know, I'm sorry because like 1% of you get carbon on a piston, right? That's a great illustration, Joe. Okay, here's some. Like plaque on your teeth. Yeah. That's what they do. Now, there's an antidote. That's nice. The antidote, though, is M. Scott Peck, remember him? Road Less Traveled? If you haven't read that book for a while, just read it again. Just pick it up and read it. What a great book. Brilliant. Beautiful. M. Scott Peck says this. He's a brilliant man who wrote a book on real love. He said, problems do not go away. They must be worked through or else they will remain forever a barrier to the growth and development of the spirit. Remember when you used to, and that's kind of a mark of maturity, I think. A mature person realizes that problems don't go away. An immature person thinks if they just ignore them, they'll take care of themselves. I'm going to give you one more high school story. My father just got a brand new Chevy Citation. Remember those? That was quite a car. Fuel injected. Ugliest car ever created by General Motors. But brand new. And I was just wailing through that town, by which I ran out of gas earlier, you know, in my high school career. And this time, in my rearview mirror, there was a policeman with his lights on. And it was, he gave me a speeding ticket. Why? Well, I was speeding. And I just thought, well, I'm just going to ignore this problem. And off I went to college. And I don't remember, probably, you know, back then, early 80s, it was probably $60 or something, I don't know. And by the time it was all paid off, a couple years later, I'm sure, I don't remember exactly, but it was hundreds of dollars. And frustrated parents, and when are, that's what immaturity does. Immaturity thinks, if I just ignore this, it's going to go away. We had some friends here this summer, and actually some family, and a relative of our family came along, and one afternoon they were in the city, and all of a sudden he fainted, bam, right to the ground, dead away, fainted dead away, unconscious. EMTs came, they, you know, hooked him up to the machines, and, you know, they said, well, you've got a blockage, heart problem. And he said, yeah, but I don't want to ruin anybody's vacation. So he signed the disclaimer, left the ambulance, and pretended it didn't happen. We would go, are you kidding me? I want to say, dude, the way to ruin someone's vacation is to die in my house. Do not do that. It just doesn't make any sense to us. But when we're talking about emotional stuff, we just let it go. And it builds up. And although it doesn't cause tightness and the numb left arm, and it actually does cause all kinds of stuff. So what's the antidote? What if you don't want to kind of do that anymore? What if you want to begin actually not letting new ones start? And, you know, that's the way to kind of, when you got a big project, you just stop doing that thing that you do, and then you kind of go back and work on some of the past ones that have accumulated. How would you do that in this idea of resentment? Listen to what God says through the pen of the Apostle Paul in Ephesians chapter 4. He says this, get rid of all bitterness, rage, and that word that's translated rage could also be translated resentment, and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave you. Here's the problem with resentment. The antidote is forgiveness. Now, I like forgiveness when it's given to me. But when I have to forgive someone who's hurt me, then I have to have several parameters checked off before I'll acquiesce to forgive, right? And so do you. It started when I was young. You know my younger brother David. He's here a couple times a month doing music. I was brutal to David as an older brother. And my mother would grab us both, and she would look at me, and I can't tell you how many wooden spoons that woman broke. So you tell your brother you're sorry. I'm sorry. I want to talk about forgiveness for just a second. And what I'm going to do is talk about reactions that we have when someone says forgive. And I want to look at this simplistically. It's not simple. Next week we're going to talk about how to forgive. This morning, I just want to talk about this. What are some of the reactions? And I've talked to a lot of people who come up with a lot of reactions. If the antidote to resentment, to letting this build up, is forgiveness, what are some of the reactions? Number one, I don't know what it means to forgive or how to forgive. And no one's ever taught me the process. I was just told, forgive them. Or you know, but I don't know what it means, really. I mean, what does it really mean? I don't know how to do it, I've realized. Well, if I forgive, it's simply excusing bad behavior. I'm not going to forgive that person because they'll do it again. I get that. Forgiveness is just like pretending it didn't happen or excusing bad behavior. Here's the funny thing. We say this. They should pay for what they did. But when you build up a resentment like that, who pays for it? Right. See, you resenting it doesn't make them pay for it. It makes you pay for it. In fact, what does resentment mean? To feel again and again and again and again. Now, I understand that you don't want to just excuse bad behavior, but I want to give you some handles on forgiveness that actually make it a process that we can work through together. Another reaction I get all the time is this: if I forgive, the other person will never be held accountable for what they did to me. See, that one's just not true. Let me just give you a scenario. Let's go to a bad scenario of an abusive relationship. And I'll give you a stereotypical one where there's a woman living with a man who is abusive. It's just awful, it's horrible, it's just unconscionable, but it's happening all the time in our community. And this woman has built up a resentment, and it's hurting her, poisoning her. And the pastor says, well, you should forgive him. What does that mean? Does that mean that she doesn't press charges? Absolutely not! The guy should go to jail. Well, how is that forgiving? Forgiveness is not for him. See, this is it. Forgiveness is not for... If I hurt Jeanette in some way, I might not even know I hurt her feelings. But even if I did, forgiveness isn't for me. Forgiveness is for Jeanette so that she doesn't feel that hurt over and over and over and over again. So forgiveness and making someone... bringing someone to justice, they're completely compatible. Does that make sense? See, some of us don't want to forgive because we have a misunderstanding of what it is. If I forgive, I'll never get even. Now that one's true. And let me ask it like this. You know, this whole get even thing, how is that working for you? How is that working in the world right now? Getting even. If your deepest desire is to hurt someone in the way that they hurt you, it's going to be a very painful several years. How about this one? If I can't forget what happened, I guess I can't forgive what happened. And that comes from this old cliche that we hear that says, oh, just forgive and forget. And when someone hurts you deeply, can you forget it? Absolutely not. See, forgiving and forgetting, I don't know who ever married those. But they're not marriageable. Now, let's just get a little bit more precise in our language. Jeanette and I again, I hurt Jeanette. And she can't forget that. I mean, I did it. I said something mean to her, or I don't know. I wouldn't hurt Jeanette. It's a horrible illustration. But somebody did this to this poor woman, and she can't forget it. Forgiving and forgetting are two different things. You know, that's the amazing thing about the way that we're made up. You're made up so that you remember stuff. You remember what that person did. You remember what she said. You remember how it all happened. And sometimes that memory is so strong, it gives you a panic attack. Forgiveness is not dependent on you forgetting it. If that were the case, we would never forgive anything. There's a difference, however, and I'll talk about that next week. But you don't have to forget. You can't forget. How about this one? If the other person isn't sorry, I can't really forgive them. Well, that puts us in a really ugly spot. Because you can't control if someone else is sorry. So that means, if that's true, that means you can only forgive people who are sorry, regret it, and really mean it. You're not going to be able to forgive very much. Some people that I talk to actually have to forgive someone who's dead. Find out if they're sorry or not. My father did this and this and this to me. But now he's dead. Does that mean they're doomed to live a life of resentment? And no, not on your life. See, if Jeanette forgives me and it's a gift that she gives to herself so that she doesn't build up resentments, it doesn't matter if I'm sorry for what I did or not. Well, what'll keep you from doing it again? Ah, that's a great question. Brings me to my next reaction. If I forgive, then I'll have to be reunited to the one who hurt me, or our relationship will have to be restored. Ridiculous. See, this is where being sorry comes in. If Jeanette and I have a friendship and I hurt her and I'm not sorry for it, she can forgive me and say, well, I forgive you, yes, but I don't want to have a friendship with you anymore. Well, that's not forgiveness. Yeah, it is. See, we just kind of attach things thinking that I can't forgive my husband or my wife or my father or my son or whatever, because if I forgive them, that means I'm going to put myself in the same position in which I was hurt in the first place. It doesn't mean that. It comes from really sloppy thinking about it, what it means to forgive. When I forgive someone who's hurt me in a dramatic way or and really forgiveness is for dramatic things. And that person doesn't seem sorry, or I'm just not safe with that person anymore, I don't ever have to see them again. You hear that? You don't ever have to see that person again. You can get a court order and make sure that they don't see you by writ of law, and still forgive them for what they did. Because forgiveness is not about them. It frees your heart. It's a gift that God has invented to free my heart from all of this carbon buildup, because I just can't control it when people do things to me. And neither can you. Now, I want to talk about forgiveness. We're going to start next week. And it might take two or three. I don't know. Is that okay with you guys? I want to talk about the process of forgiveness. How do I forgive? Now, for that to be as effective as possible, you need to kind of come with some working resentments. Come with some juicy ones. Now, you don't have to share them. Here's two things that I'd like you to do this week for homework. Number one, so last week I said kind of keep track of your resentments, and that may not have been enough information, but what I want you to do is keep track of your triggers. What triggered you? Now, by the way, remember, let me just say this, and I'm done in 2 minutes, more than likely. Let me just say it like this. Remember where I said there's three big ideas that the spiritual tradition says are keys to spiritual health. If you don't resent. What's the second one? Don't react. Guess what? There's an order to these. There's no way you're not going to be react, that you're not going to, that you're going to react if you don't clear out your resentments. You see how they work? And if you have deep resentments and deep reactions, you're never going to have inner peace. That's why some of us can't keep quiet sometimes. So you know what? I'm just going to meditate. And we sit still. And what does our head say? I mean, it's just like, it's just so loud in there. Why? There's a lot of stuff going on. So when I begin excising my resentments, my reactions begin to stop on their own, actually. And my inner peace begins to settle in a way that I never have known it before. So what are your triggers? Just keep track. Be aware. Pay attention to yourself. Something that sets you off, that is not in and of itself enough to set you off, will give you a clue that there's a resentment somewhere in there. And then just get curious with yourself. And the second one if this whole forgiveness thing, you know, so the best book I've ever read on this idea is a book written by Lewis Smedes. The name is in your notes. You could click online today and have this at your door tomorrow or Tuesday. It's called The Art of Forgiving. When You Need to Forgive and Don't Know How. Best book I've ever read on forgiveness. It's brilliant and workable and not pie in the sky and not ridiculous. There are some books on forgiveness that are ridiculous. You go, that's ridiculous, I say. And I close the book. And I want my money back. That's not so with this book. So if this is something that is pertinent, this is a good resource. You'll go, now that's the kind of book I like. Underline, sticky note. So next week we're going to pick up right here. And I want to talk about the process of forgiveness. What do the scriptures have to say? What does God have to say? And how does that agree with the process? Where is this thing? How do we forgive? We have been set free. Our chains have been cut. But in the area of resentment, we live as if we're still bound. And my hope is over the next couple weeks to just do a little bit of work and help us see what's really true. So let's pray. God, thank you. I want to thank you for the pain that we have lived through and the beauty that we've lived through, because it kind of turns our hearts towards what's real and what isn't, and it gets us thinking, kickstarts us, Father. So thank you. But God, there are a lot of people in this room who have suffered in a lot of ways, and there are a lot of things that have settled in as deep and abiding resentments that have become walls, protections, really, so that it doesn't happen again. And I pray that you'd help us to identify them and work through them, begin to work through them, so that we can let light in on places that haven't seen the light of day in a long time. I'm grateful that that is your work, oh love. And I pray that you would help us to let you do that work in us. Pray this in Jesus' name. Thanks, you guys. Have a great day.
Just one more thing. For those of you who know Steve Cole, tomorrow Steve has to have spinal surgery on his back. They don't know what time. They don't know exactly what it's going to entail, but he has a growth that needs to be removed. So if you could please keep Steve Cole in your... just keep them in your forefront tomorrow and pray for them. They have a long road to hoe. So let's remember them as we sing this song. This is Judy and I's favorite song. And she couldn't be here today because they couldn't find a nurse for last night. So she has to take care of Colton today and then take care of Steve for the next couple weeks. So if you'll stand with me and sing this as loud as possible. She's watching right now. So let's sing this for the Coles. Amen. Have a great day, everyone.